What have you heard from your players about this tight turnaround?
Well, we really haven't heard much about it. You know, last night, obviously, there was the vote, and I've been kind of operating as if training camp was going to start December 1st, and we were going to start the season December 22nd. So as far as the preparation is concerned, it really hasn't been that much of a surprise. But it is a short window, and I have a lot that I want to do, but mainly for me, it's the players and making sure that the players are going to be healthy and that we ramp it up in a smart way to where there won't be any injuries or lagging or lingering injuries going forward.
Coach, I can't even put into words how happy I am for you to be an assistant coach in the NBA for 20 years. I haven't, you know, obviously it was a long time since I've seen your dad, but, you know, I'm very familiar with you and the job that you've done over the last 20 years as an assistant. Congratulations to you. I want to know, what was it about this job that you liked so much? We say James Harden, we say Russell Westbrook, but there's so many questions about them. I'm told both of them signed off on you, and obviously ownership obviously believes in you a lot. Talk to me about what was attractive for you in regards to this job.
Well, there's so much. I mean, it starts with ownership, and Tillman Fertitta has a plan and believes in me and is not afraid to spend, which is amazing. And as you've alluded to in previous interviews, that, you know, you need an owner that believes in you, especially as a young African-American coach, and that's just fact. And that really shows what kind of guy he is and what kind of management that we have here. Rafael Stone is the new GM, and I enjoy talking to him, and we clicked right away. And a lot of the things that I believe as far as how basketball should be played that I've learned from my dad and Don Nelson and Rick Carlisle over the years are a lot of the things that they're interested in here as well. And then, as you alluded to have two of the best players in the NBA, two MVPs, two future Hall of Famers, and the ability to win it and win it all where I don't have to be in a rebuilding situation. This is the ideal job for me after working for so long and so hard to get to this point, to be with this organization. It's a perfect fit.
Coach, congratulations on the job, and you inherit a good roster, and a roster that seemed like when they traded Capella, I'm like, what are they? They must get a center. No, they went what they call micro ball, right? So Westbrook stopped shooting so much, he penetrates and either kicks or finishes, and he's where you get the paint play, and it's a new, like, the next level of what we're seeing in the NBA. So I wonder, what changes? Are you continuing with that lineup as the kind of basis of the offense, or are you making changes to that concept?
Well, it's really based on how Rafael and I, and mostly Rafael, puts the roster together. You know, the small ball was very much a product of the roster that they had. Obviously, I want to have multiple ways of playing. I think to have playoff success, you have to have multiple ways of playing on both ends of the floor. So having a traditional center would be good for me, so I would be able to play small like they've done in the past and like I did 15 years ago when I worked for Don Nelson, and then play big with a rolling center and someone playing in the dunker, and the matchups would be a little bit better for our group, and then the defense and the rebounding would be a little bit better as well. So my goal is to have multiple ways of playing on both ends of the floor, and Rafael's looking to put together a roster so I can do so.
I can imagine your answer to this question, but I'll ask it anyway. Obviously, Mike D'Antoni, incredibly innovative offensively. The man is brilliant on the offensive side of the ball. Defense, I won't get into that. I'm trying to be nice today. But in the end, but in the end, what it comes down to is this. People look at the team that he's coached over the last several years, recognizing him as a pretty damn good coach. But in the end, you look at Russell, you look at James Harden, you look at a team that's built to be successful in the regular season, not necessarily the postseason. Specifically, if you can speak to it, how would you modify things compared to what we've seen from the Houston Rockets over the last 4 or 5 years? What would you do to have them better prepared for a postseason run?
Yeah, that's a really good point. And you use the regular season to prepare for the playoffs, right? So if you have multiple ways of playing, if you have the ability to play bigger or play smaller, now when you get to the playoffs, you have multiple tools in your toolbox to go to. There won't be quite as many isolations as we've seen in the past. Those guys have had to work so hard to get to their greatness and get to what makes them really successful. But in the playoffs, you see it stalls because there aren't really a third, fourth option to go to. So for my point of view, optionality is going to be everything. And getting a little bit more ball movement, getting a little bit more player movement, letting those guys play on the move a little bit more so they won't see quite as many double teams. And then as the playoffs come, we can go to that stuff to where it won't be quite as predictable, especially in a 5-7 game series when you're trying to deal with someone who's preparing and sees you game after game after game. You have to have something else to go to, and that's what I'm planning to do.
Coach, the philosophy under Daryl Morey and Mike D'Antoni was, I don't think the Rockets ever had the best guys in terms of converting all these things, but they placed the most good bets. Threes, paint, free throws. We're just going to do that because those are the best bets you can make, and we're going to keep doing that. And we've seen, as you said, in the playoffs, like a guy like Rondo succeed because he's like a coach on the floor, and that's really coach's time, the playoff plays out of timeouts, and who understands it the best. So it does this, what you're talking about, empower James Harden and Russell Westbrook in certain ways, you think, more than they were empowered in the past?
I would give them more ownership and optionality to be able to do different things on the floor. But for me to come in here and expect for the team that's the sixth best offensive team in the NBA to change and go away from the things that were successful doesn't make any sense to me. So those guys are going to be doing very much, they're going to be playing very much in a similar way, but with some tweaks and some adjustments to make it a little bit easier for them.
Thanks for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN+.